Hi. There's a surprise guest tonight, and I'm very happy to announce the special advisor to President Hollande and the man who is responsible for organizing COP21, Nicolas Hulot. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here.
I will be very brief. For one reason, I don't speak English, so I get only a few words, but the only thing I want to tell you, thanks to be there for, first for Paul Watson, it's a great man, but it's not only a great man, it's he carries with him something who is essential. Some people have not still understood, and if we don't protect ocean, we will lose with the ocean. But the main thing who is important, we are not only in front of an environmental crisis. We are in front of something deeply, a cultural crisis. You know, our civilization wins on technological aspect, but we lose on cultural aspect. We lose the sense. We lose the conscience. We have enough technology. We have enough economy. But we have not a vision. We have an opportunity. I don't know if we will use it to write a new chapter of the human history. We are invited to do a trip in humanity. I don't know if we will do it. I don't know if we will be able to change our economic model. Who is not the solution? Who is the problems? Are we able to become at end human? Are we really human? That's the question we must answer very fast. In Paris, there is a lot of hope, of course. Will the chief of state be able to answer to this hope? I hope. Because Paris is not only an environmental conference, it's a conference for peace. Because climate crisis, like ocean crisis, add inequity, injustice to injustice, poverty to poverty, misery to misery. That's the ultimate injustice, because that's always poor people who are first in front. But now, as you know, the Earth is smaller than we imagine. We live in a small village. We are connected by internet, and everybody in the world is able to take conscience suddenly that he has not the same value, the same attention than somebody in another part of the world. And when you add to the inequality something with like explosive, with humiliation, when you humiliate people, you explain what happened in the world. So we are at a specific time of our civilization. We can still decide, as Paul Watson said, we can still save the ocean. We can still save humanity. But the time is very short. The window is very short. It's not tomorrow. It's now. And as I told you, as the main problem is cultural, that's a good reason to have cultural people, artists, and all people who can design the world of tomorrow. And to come back to the beauty, because only the beauty will save the world. Thank you.
I'm very happy to be here. And I'm very thankful you came. And I'm going to tell you quickly what we do. And then we find out if you like it, because end of the day, we're here to recruit you. Because we need more people to help us. It's very simple. First slide, please. So in 2012, I met Captain Paul Watson. And when I met him, I realized that I can't keep doing what I did. And I can't like keep designing products and ignoring that the planet has a problem and that our oceans are sick. So we started together, me and my partners, we started Parley for the Ocean as a platform, as a network to bring together the creative industries, us, with major brands whom we work for or whom we consulted forever, and environmentalists who normally don't speak to the creators, I mean, sometimes to the creators, but not so eager in speaking to the companies because they don't like so much what they're doing. So Parley is a collaboration network, a collaboration space, and it's meant to, on one side, create awareness for the fragility and the beauty of the oceans, because most of us, we just don't know that the oceans are so amazingly beautiful and important for us. And if you don't have a personal relationship, you might not even care that they die, because there is nothing in it for you, you think. But end of the day, we all depend on a solid and healthy marine life and biodiversity and a solid ecosystem out there. So what we thought is, I learned from Captain Paul Watson in June 2012 firsthand what's going on out there, and it was a shock for me. And I want to give you this shock too, without traveling to Frankfurt and going to a little law firm and sitting there with the pirate version of Santa Claus, the most inspiring person. I want to make it easier for you here, nice, in Paris. And our mission is, end of the day, that we have a deadline here, and that's 2048. That's what people said, what scientists said, and probably it's way earlier, probably it's 2030 even, that all the fish you know, all the fish you eat, everything what you see in a supermarket, in a fridge, will be not there anymore, or will be raised in a lab or in a farm. But it will not live out there in the ocean anymore. The ocean will be dead. And that's something I personally can't accept, and I hope you can't either. So next slide, please. So end of the day, what I learned after, or we learned as a group after the first Palais we did, it was hosted by Julian Schnabel, who generously supported us from day one, and he painted our logo and everything. And we realized one thing: you can have the most amazing, beautiful dinner as this here, and I can make you cry, and all other people who come here will make you cry, and there will be so many tears come down, and everybody will be so touched and humble, and you go home, and tomorrow you're going to go to a sushi restaurant, because it's just what you do. You're used to it, and you don't even think, and I don't even think, and we are just not aware that our actions are so directly related to the sea. And that's why we have to make it a business, end of the day. Because business is what people, everybody cares about, and we learned that very hard, and I think it's not something negative, it's something great. We want to create things, we want to build things, we want to, that's in us human, we want to innovate, and we want to be rewarded with money for that, and that's why we feel that everything that we do should be a very good opportunity, and we want actually to be seeing that if you care for the oceans, you go for the oceans, you support the oceans, that you're making better business. So we want to make it more lucrative for you, together with you, to make the oceans the core of your life, the core of your personal life, and the core of your professional life. That's our mission here. And I hope there's, yeah, exactly. Oh, sorry, there's one more. Cross-intelligence, that's what we do at Parley. We find out how can we combine opponents, how can we make peace, and that's the name Parley actually, it has it in it. How can we make peace between opponents? How can we bring people together? How can we inspire to form alliances? And even if we are not involved anymore, it's great if people just do, you know, and partner up, because not one person will be able to turn this around. And I just invite you to this here. It's a collaboration space, and we're going to be here tonight. We're kicking it off here, but we're going to be here tomorrow night, and we're going to be here on Thursday in a total smaller circle, and we're going to be in Friday, and we're going to, as Parley, be there, always there for you to. You can reach out to us, send us emails, and just say, hey, you know what, I want to be part of this. I want to support. And that's pretty much everything I have to say. I want to show a film now that hopefully says something to you. And it's Captain Paul Watson now on the screen.
This spaceship that we are on, is like any other spaceship. It has a life support system, and that life support system is the biosphere. And it provides us everything we need to live on spaceship Earth, the food we eat, the energy that we need, the light, it regulates the temperature, it regulates the weather. And the biosphere is maintained by a crew of citizens on board the spaceship Earth. Three. So we're all in it together that way. But many of the crew are more important than others. Some species are just plain passengers, not doing really too much, but having a great time entertaining ourselves. Humans being probably in the first class section of that passenger ship right there. And we're taking up an awful lot of room in that first class section and using up a lot of resources, which means that we're contributing to the death and the extinction of really important crew members. Those species that run this planet, that provide the oxygen that we breathe, that provide the food that we eat, that regulate the weather. The most important, of course, being bacteria and plankton and algae, and then followed up by insects and worms and then fish. People get upset when I say that worms are more important than people, but on spaceship Earth, worms are more important than people because we need the worms to run the spaceship. We don't need people to do it. Passengers are just sitting around, but the worms are making it possible for us to be here. We need the worms, but they don't need us. We need bees, they don't need us. We need fish, they don't need us. So these species are far more important to us because without them, we wouldn't exist. So I think that it's really the responsibility of the passengers on spaceship Earth to watch out for the welfare of the crew members that are running this ship, and that is all of those species, those engineering species, which are maintaining this life support system.
Clap to him. So I would like to introduce someone, because I felt not fit to host this in the headquarters of style and pop culture and Les Bains. So I asked my good friend Jefferson Heck, who is the icon maker.
Oh, wow.
He's the icon maker. And welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Cyrill. Thank you so much, Nicolas Olo, for his introduction earlier. And thank you all for being here tonight. Well, I really wouldn't want to be anywhere else in the world right now. This is such a powerful and prescient moment in our times, and we can all feel the urgency of what's happening in the world all around us right now. So we're in Les Bains. And you're probably asking yourselves, how is this all going to work? How are we going to get something meaningful, something positive, out of bringing all you smart people in the room tonight? And you really are a smart group. You're not just talkers, you're doers. So the format for tonight is going to be that we're going to have talks for 45 minutes, then we're going to break for dinner, then there's going to be another 45 minutes of talks, and then we're going to let our hair down and have a good time. It's going to be my role to introduce what's happening through the night and introduce the different speakers, but they're more than speakers. They're really, really incredible individuals. Legends, luminaries, guiding lights of ocean conservation, fearless individuals who are helping us navigate a better future for ourselves, our relationship to each other, our relationship to our planet, and for a better world. But I've written something, because I can't keep everything in my head, so I wrote a speech that I was going to read out, but there's been an interruption. We're going to go live to Rome almost instantaneously. I've been punked by David de Rothschild, and he's in Rome right now at the Vatican. We have something incredibly special to share with you. We've got a live feed to Rome, and I don't know how exactly it's going to work. This is a bit rock and roll. We're sort of making it up as we go along.
Can I shoot it?
But Cyrill.
Yes.
I think you know a little bit more about what's going on. So just introduce Rome, then we'll cut live and we'll go and we'll bring the Vatican to us on this screen.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for bringing me back up. So, David, what's up?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, a delay.
There might be a slight delay.
Yes, there is a slight delay.
So tell us, what the hell is going on? We're here in Les Bains. You've got a captive audience.
Well, I am standing right now in front of the Vatican, and what you're seeing behind me is the projections that have been shown in the film Racing Extinction, Luis Sahoyas and the Obscura digital team. In the other direction, we must be probably close to about, I'd say, 100,000 people. And if you can look over my shoulder, you can start to see there's a marmot, there's a meerkat, rather, on the Vatican. It's quite a surreal, not to be confused with Cyrill, quite surreal. This is a culmination of work. I saw Louis earlier. There's a huge team here inside of the Vatican. And it's been going on for about an hour now. And we believe the Pope is in residence. And I don't know if you can see that behind me.
You can see now
we're in the jungles of the Amazon. There's 360 degrees of sound. This is a huge undertaking by many people, and from what I can hear in the background, from what you were talking about, this is.
Did you see the Pope?
This is bringing many people's dream alive.
Can I ask you some questions?
We've been seeing the oceans. We've been seeing different species. Yes, of course. Please do.
Okay, so you arrived today, and how long did you wait to get this up and to see what's going on there? And who is there? Did you see the Pope?
So it's very hard. I mean, the fact that we're filming right now, we may get shut down. We're doing this on the fly.
Incredible.
There's a lot of people here. There's probably about 100,000 people here. There's a lot of dignitaries. I believe there's the mayor of Rome, the Pope is here. He's apparently watching, probably from a window.
He got a good seat.
Who else is in the audience?
Sure. I learned that there are some interesting people sitting around.
It's hard to hear you, but I mean, what I'll describe is an incredibly surreal scene. We're now seeing ice bears and melting ice and receding glaciers that are breaking apart. The sound is kind of deafening. People are in awe. People are looking around, and I think no one's seen anything like this. I certainly haven't seen anything like this before. It's something that you will not forget. And I spoke to Louis earlier, and he said, his mission is to get this to a broader audience as possible. It's not about making a movie; it's about starting a movement. And I think that's what he's trying to do: is start a movement. And I think when you look around and you see the hundreds of thousands of people literally looking at this, it is. Pretty amazing. We've managed to get into an area where we're probably not meant to be standing. So
David, can your camera...
But it's pretty beautiful. I hope you can see what's going on behind me.
David, can your cameraman give us a POV of the crowd? Quick spin.
You have to... if we have to turn around, they're all behind the barriers, and you can't really see. There's a point of view of the crowd. They go all the way back. We're in right in the square, and if you see where those lights are... Down there is the Pilgrim Walk, it's called, and that is full, wall to wall. There must be about 80,000 people to 100,000 people down there. They've just cleared out this inner square. We were meant to leave. We decided to stay to bring this broadcast, which is out in a second.
So quickly, for everybody who didn't,
around,
for everybody who doesn't know what the message is about, can you quickly bring together what the projection and the film says?
So this is, as I said, this is part of the Racing Extinction film. This is a film that was 6 years in the making, talking about the sixth mass extinction, the Anthropocene era, an era which we're in right now, which is, human fingerprints, carbon is obviously at highest record levels. And how do we get people to not just think about these things, but, act on the solutions, do just one thing? And this is what Louis' dream was. When I met him 6 years ago after the Cove, he said, I never expected to have so much of a positive reaction and impact with a film. The next thing I do, I want to make a movement. The film went live around the world to about 600 million people on Discovery about, I think it was about 2 weeks ago now. And throughout the filming, there's interviews with a number of great wildlife photographers, conservationists, scientists, activists. And it documents the story of, you know, really our evolution as a species that is using more than we should. And we all know that now. And so the question is, how do we act? The time is now, obviously, with the COP conversations are part of this, is trying to get people to be re-engaged. And to think about the fact that we have to get to 1.5 degrees.
David, we're humbled by what we're seeing. We wish you were here with us now, but we're even more grateful that you're over there doing what you're doing. We all want to give you all our love, all of our support, and a huge round of applause for this incredible achievement. Show him the love.
Hey. All right, guys.
come.
We'll see you soon. Good luck back there. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, David. Bye.
We wave you goodbye.
Thank you very much.
What an incredible act of cultural activism. I hope they don't get shut down. I hope that's allowed to go on all night long till daybreak. Wow, David, what an amazing man. I don't know if many of you know, but he did a project called Plastiki, where he built a raft out of plastic bottles and sailed it into the middle of the plastic mass in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And what a heroic gesture and activist he is. So I'm just going to introduce myself. I'm Jefferson Hack. I'm the founder of Dazed Media. And in 1991, all that time ago, in the spirit of independent press before me, I founded my first publication, Dazed and Confused magazine. And it was an antidote and rebellion against the systems of media that prevailed in our society. It was the voice of a new generation who was sick of being told how to think and act by the establishment. Today, it continues in that spirit, and we reach 8 million individuals online and hundreds of thousands in our print publications, Dazed, Another Man, and Another Magazine. Ever since our climate change issue in 2005, we've been discussing the threat of global warming, and we've been applying our principles of punk positivism to global conservation, highlighting the realities of our planet with the same perspective of revolution that we do with our style agenda. We want to snap people out of indifference and monotony and engage them with radical action and creative generosity. Vivienne Westwood, who's here with us tonight, interviewed James Lovelock, the author of Gaia, for her guest-edited issue of Dazed. Sea Shepherd's activism, the explorations and research of David de Rothschild, the intrepid life of Sylvia Earle, they've all been reported on and championed in my publications. And the work of many of you in the room and many of those who are speaking tonight have been covered. It's an honor to be invited by Parley, by Cyrill, to co-host the evening as an alternative to and simultaneously connected to the urgent moment of COP21. Everything starts with a conversation. I met Cyrill about 9 months ago, so this is a new relationship, a new bond that's been formed very, very quickly. And I was immediately identified with his modern approach to the issue of ocean conservation. He unites key players in the environmental space and bridges their conversation across science and culture, and he's created a new method for a genuine type of collaboration. He calls it eco-innovation. I've seen the results of it firsthand. It's astounding. In the last 12 months, Parley has successfully put the issue of ocean plastic on the map. And it's just the beginning. His brand of eco-innovation is about doing things differently. Tonight, we're going to hear from a lot of rebel thinkers who are passionate about preserving the planet and finding solutions about how we manage planet ocean. It's also about people who do things differently. We both share a belief, me and Cyrill, we both share a belief that designers and the creative communities within industry have the greatest capacity to innovate solutions. You can adopt new practices, implement them from within, and literally hack the system. These are the solutions of scientific, these are not the solutions of scientific dogma. These are creative approaches that don't rely on conventional tropes of ethical consumerism or on government. But they offer new routes, new modes of production for brands, the invention of revolutionary materials. You see, the dream of eradicating and seriously challenging plastic manufacture, for instance, is within reach. Tomorrow there's going to be a day dedicated to collaboration. I think Cyrill mentioned it. We're going to be here for 3 days, and we're going to be looking for potential solutions across key pillars in ocean welfare. It's action, not words, solutions, not rhetoric, that's needed now more than ever. We all know it's urgent. We're about to reach a point of no return. I'm going to give you just a few statistics. By 2030, over 90% of all coastal zones worldwide will be developed. By 2048, all fishing species will collapse if we continue at the rate of fishing that's forecasted. And if we sustain the present rate of sea level rise, in the next 100 years, we can expect flooding of lowlands throughout the world. And as Nicolas said earlier, it will affect those, it will affect many. Many will die, and it will affect the poor first, and they will become refugees from their homes. I don't believe government will make a difference. I really don't. Whatever's going on here at COP21, outside of this room, for me, I think that for politicians, it will be business as usual, just with more spin, more rhetoric, and more sophisticated economic climate accounting. We have the ability here, through eco-innovation, to change manufacturing habits from within. Through the intersection of design, science and technology, we and others like us will affect change. Also, with Parley, for all stakeholders in Planet Ocean, and there's a lot of you in the room who all are focusing on different aspects of it, it's a chance to be united and understand that together we're stronger than we are alone. The destruction of the ocean is everyone's problem. It's one global body of water that transcends traditional boundaries. It makes our points of difference irrelevant. We live in extraordinary times, we really do, but we also live in extraordinarily dark times. They're indifferent and they're extraordinarily fragile, but they're also, therefore, extraordinarily opportunistic. The status quo distrusts any change, especially any positive change. It really does. It wants things to stay exactly the fucking same. Yet we are all here, all of us agents of change. All of us have a high level of power and influence within our respective fields. We can begin to rewrite the rules together. Everyone here is a part to play in the solution. By being here tonight, you are parlaying, or should I say, well, yeah, you're parlaying, you're being a part of it. You wouldn't be here if you weren't searching for answers and ultimately searching for truth. And this is the rub of it for me. I feel we're all truth seekers. And tonight, over the course of this dinner, we will have the chance to listen to many great truths. Some sad, shocking, shameful, downright unbelievable, others positive, utopic, and truly inspirational. For without truth, and without those willing to stand in their own truth, we all know there's no chance for real change. So I want to raise a toast. I want everyone to put their to hold a glass, raise a toast, to parlay, to tonight, to what's about to happen, to some magic that we're going to create over the next hour and a half. And I want to say, to dream a dream alone is only a dream, but to dream a dream together is reality. So let's make a new reality tonight. So I'm going to introduce our first speaker, Gulliaume Néry. Gulliaume is an amazing individual, freediving champion, diving teacher, film producer, explorer. He's the French freediving champion. Come on the stage. He's a multiple world record holder and a double reigning world champion. It's a privilege for us to have him. But before he comes and speaks, we're gonna show a film of his achievements, and then he's gonna take the stage. All right, dim the lights for the film. Hello. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So my name is Gulliaume Néry, and I've been a freediving competitor for more than 15 years now. And during those 15 years, I tried to feed my need to explore the underwater world and to explore the unknown. I broke several times the world record. I became 2 times world champions. I can hold my breath for up to 8 minutes. I can dive to 126 meters, which is my last record. But this is not interesting. This is not the most important thing. What is important is that during those 15 years, what was fascinating is trying to find out what was the keys to get accepted by the deep ocean, because it's not easy to get down there. And I discovered some secrets, and it was the only way for me to reach such a depth. And what I found out and what is surprisingly interesting is that those keys are very interesting to understand and that could be used for human to understand the relation between us and our planet, how it should be. So just to explain me, to explain you a little bit what's happening during a deep dive. When I'm leaving the surface, I'm leaving the comfort world. I'm trying to enter the unknown. I'm leaving the surface. I'm leaving the lights. I'm leaving the people I love. And I'm going into the darkness. And the more I'm going down, the more the light is disappearing, the more the water is getting cold and colder and colder. And I can feel the pressure. The pressure is squeezing my body and it's getting huge. And at this stage, the only way to get accepted by the elements, by the ocean, is not to fight, not to go against the ocean, not to resist, but to let go and to accept. Acceptance is one key of the deep exploration in freediving. And if I get to this stage of acceptance, I can feel a kind of harmony. I feel the harmony, like you can imagine I'm suffering, I have pain and everything, but not at all. If I change my state of mind, I really feel a deep harmony between my body, my mind, and the elements. And then I get to the bottom. It's not finished. And then I get to the bottom, and as I just told you, when I get there, if I'm in a good state of mind, I just don't feel pain. I don't need to breathe. I just feel amazingly good down there. And I have one other feeling that comes to me immediately. Like, I look around and I just realize that it's just dark blue all around me. If I look up, down, left, right, forward, backward, I just see the same thing, just deep blue. And I just feel like I'm just a little drop lost in the middle of the infinity. And the first feeling I have is like I have to be humble because I'm just nothing. I'm just a little drop of nothing lost in the middle of the big thing. And this is the only way for me to survive this place and to be able to come back. And then I'm leaving the bottom and I'm trying to reach the surface and I'm swimming back. As you could see on the film, I have to swim back like a marine mammal. And my main concern at this stage, my main focus is how to save energy. Because I'm on a single breath of air. My reserve of oxygen is limited. I cannot waste energy, so I just have to focus on being efficient. And I realize how precious is the oxygen, how precious is the energy,
And I keep this in my mind all the way up. And this is how I can go back to the surface with a big smile. And what is fascinating, if I take a step back and I look at those keys, I just take this as a message. This is a real message I got from the ocean. And I really think that's all human being. I wish that one day all human being could experience this, like really live this to understand it. Because I really think that you should live an experience to understand and to go forward. So today, I'm not competing anymore. But I'm still freediving, of course. This is my passion. And I'm using freediving as a way to show the underwater world with another vision, with another perception, with another angle. We are doing films with my wife on breast hold, and we try to capture the magic of the underwater world. And we try to spread this message to the world because we truly believe that what is important is people have to feel emotions. If people are looking those images and feel emotions, they're dreaming. And if they're dreaming, they want to go in the water. And this is one of our goals, is to make people come back to the water. Because we all come from the water, and we have to be aware about it. And what we want is just that people love the ocean. Because this is it. It's all about love. If people love, they respect. And if they respect, they will protect. Thank you.
Wow, thank you. That was incredibly inspirational. His message of love and particular humility is incredibly profound. Thank you so much, Guillaume. I'm now proud to present our next speaker, which is Patricia Ricard, who is the director of the Oceanographic Institute, which was founded by her father, Paul Ricard, in 1966, an incredible institute that's doing an amazing amount of research that we all benefit from to understand how the oceans are working and what can be done. So I'd like to welcome Patricia to the stage. Thank you.
Well,
I'd like you all to welcome Patricia to the stage.
Well, I can't see you. It's a pity because I know you're listening with all your heart. And I would like to thank Cyrill to organizing that poly, because that's what it's all about. I just spent a couple of days, like maybe most of you, in the COP, trying with some friends, and some are in the room. Bravo, Romain Troublé. We tried to raise attention and awareness to the people who were leading the COP to say, oceans is our essential. Ocean is the master of climate. COP21, we had to wait 21 COPs that the master of climate should be slightly approached and slightly considered. Just give me you some facts. One breath out of two you take comes from the ocean. The water you drink comes from the ocean. The extra warm the sun gives us and our activities and our extra greenhouse gas does on the Earth is absorbed by the ocean. The ocean feeds us, feeds one man out of two in the world. When I was a child, I was going on the boat with my grandpa. I was lucky enough to be on board with some scientists. And the ocean was so present that I always had the feeling that the mainland, Earth, was just the bottom of the sea getting out the water. Because that's the truth. We're on the boat, surrounded by water, two-thirds of the planet. When you go at school, they just teach you the world, but they just teach you one-third, the mainland. They never talk about this, about the sea. All the maps always stops where the water ends. So that we need to talk about that. And which is even more sad is that when you talk to the scientists and you're a child, they explain you with very simple words. And thanks God, I was very lazy. I never went to any scientific education. So they still talk to me like a child. So I understand when they talk to me. There's nothing more generous to explain and to share your knowledge. But the time is ticking. How can we have all the people who makes difference, who makes political decision, listen to the scientists, talking to them like a child? So that's why we need you guys. We need your talents. If you can't explain, touch. If you can't show, make a movie. If you can't really take someone by the hand and explain long figures, long facts, scientific terms are not really easy. Make a song. Do whatever it needs to explain that oceans are essential, but more essential. They're generous. And you know what? It's full of solutions. Sometimes when I listen to the slowing and still it's going better, talkings about specialists and politicians, and you know the solutions are all around them. Nature is a genius. Nature starts 4 billion years ago. If you take the evolution on one calendar, you know, like the one you hang on the kitchen, like the one the fireman gives to you, life appears 1st January in the morning, 1st, 2nd. We arrive 31 December, just before New Year's Eve. And that's what happens. We arrive so late. We arrive numerous. 1st billion people on Earth, 1811. 2nd billion people on Earth, 1945. 4th million people on Earth, 1968, the famous baby boomer. Today with 7 million, going to 8 and maybe 10 within 20 years. We arrive late. We didn't take time to encounter, understand, or just meet the other people living, the other souls living with us on this hand, the animals, the vegetables, all the intelligence. They have been living so harmoniously, so gracefully on Earth for such a long time. We arrive as a crowd, as a spoiled child. We eat everything, we beat everything, we treat everything, we spoiled everything. Ocean was the most stable element of life for billions of years. We changed the chemical of the ocean within 200 years. We are so good at doing bad. It's amazing. And you know what? We don't even want to do it in purpose. We just need to work together. Today, there's too much knowledge to be held by one only person, one only country, one only company. We need to be all together. We need an amazing, harmonious concert of our brains, knowledge, means, money, companies, politicians, legal. We need to make the most beautiful network of goodwill to save the ocean. That's what Parley understands. Someone, I don't know to say it in English, I might say it in French, a gorgeous scientist and a humanist, because sometimes scientists, humanists, and artists are at the same level of sharing and giving. The man was called Theodore Monod. He says a beautiful thing. He said, I become the links that I need. I hope you will become a gorgeous net. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Patricia. Thank you so much, Patricia. Nature is the genius. It really is, and we are the spoiled children who inherited that genius. I loved your message of togetherness, and together we can all make the difference. Harmony. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Ian Urbina, New York Times investigative reporter and filmmaker, to the stage to tell us more about his incredible work with climate change, with oceans. Welcome, Ian, and please welcome him.
Thank you so much. So I promised them that I would stay under 7 minutes, and that's my main goal. As was said, I'm an investigative reporter for the New York Times, and for the last 2 years, we've been running a series called The Outlaw Ocean. The goal of that series was to investigate and explore lawlessness on the high seas. There's a lot to do there. One big realization very early on was that the lawlessness that exists out there is certainly an environmental problem. The shipping industry and ships specifically produce more, you know, intentionally dump more oil than the Exxon Valdez and the BP spill combined every 3 years. They emit in per year more toxic gases than all cars combined on the globe. So there's a real environmental concern, not to mention the raking of the seas of fish. But there's also a huge labor concern, and that became the focus of the series. And I think it's an important thing to keep in mind. There are millions of people that work out there, and the stories investigated murder on camera that no country would investigate, stowaways caught on board, thrown overboard and left at sea, children enslaved on fishing boats. There's a very broad labor and human rights concern, and I do think that as we think about the oceans and preserving them, it's important to remember that the solutions that we come up with, the people in this room, for protecting the oceans probably are ones that need to think about how to better also protect the people that are out there. I think I have 4 minutes left. So I will just briefly talk about a couple problems in particular. This particular photo has to do with weaponization of the high seas, a problem that rarely gets discussed. There's a huge arms trade on the high seas. A lot of weapons from conflict zones end up on boats, fishing boats in particular. And there's a lot of unchecked violence on the high seas that you never hear about, and not Somali piracy, but of a different sort. This is one example of the sorts of problems out there that I think the ocean community, which is all of you, have to bear in mind as you figure out, you know, what are some of the fixes for better patrolling and protecting the oceans. I would also say, and this is Paul Watson's group, The Chase of the Thunder, another perfect example of the sort of hand-in-glove relationship between human trafficking and sea slavery and illegal fishing and government inaction, all in one story. Here's a ship for which the men on the board, these are the crew from the Thunder that were rescued by Sea Shepherd, you know, mostly Indonesians, many of them indentured. You know, they're trafficked into a country, put on boats, they disappear at sea, and often are sent home 2 years later with no wages. And so these are the guys that are engaging the illegal fishing that made $60 million for a Spanish syndicate, but the crew are not the ones that collect those wages. So these are complicated problems, but I just think it's important to remember. Lastly, I'll talk about this story, which is filmed in the Philippines. It has to do with all these young men are Filipino boys, mostly, most of them under the age of 17, who took jobs from shady trafficking companies that brought them onto into the country and put them on ships. And most of them ended up getting sent home. These are Taiwanese tuna longliners, never having earned a wage. And two of them died very brutal deaths. So these are fairly severe crimes that I think should not be forgotten as we think of things like seafood traceability and how we can better monitor ships. We should also monitor what's happening on them. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Ian, for those incredible insights on the lawlessness of the high seas and the cost, the human cost, that is happening beyond the scope of justice. So I would like to invite to the stage Cyrill Gutsch, and to join him, Paul Watson and Vivienne Westwood. They're going to have a conversation. None of them need any introduction, so I'm just going to wait for them to get set up. Wow, I feel like we are just being... so much has been revealed in such a short space of time already. I know you're hungry, but it's worth it to wait for these incredible speakers. Bring it up here, I'll help you. Come on. Come on, let's get this show on the road. It's rock and roll. We've all got a role to play. So, Dame Vivienne Westwood. Mr. Paul Watson.
Thank you.
And our interviewer for this part of the evening, Cyrill Gutsch. T- Take it over.
Vivienne wants to interview, so I'll do it. So happy to have you here.
Yeah. I think in view of the fact that we don't have so much time, I'll kind of start. I'll take charge. Sorry. Anyway, because you have to try and fit so much into a short space. And so I just want to give a little bit background, then I want to speak to Paul. And we're here at this COP21. I think the politicians are here just as a token that the public wants them to come. Well, they can go away with their figure because we might as well ignore it. It's totally going to be worthless. And they needn't have bothered to come, actually. But nevertheless, it's good that they show willing because we can sort of put that pressure on them that you actually did take a step in the direction of something that needs to be done. Politicians are our enemies. So activists, what do activists do? They do what I do. We all do the same thing. Throughout the world, as I just said, politicians are our enemies, and we have to fight battles, and we cannot let one battle, we cannot miss one battle. We've got to keep on fighting them. It's the only way to sort of wear them down. We absolutely have to do that. So in England in particular, we have to immediately, constantly, always fight fracking. Otherwise, it'll happen. However, the British public is really on our side by now. These things do work. And I do think that politicians are, honestly, they're weak and they're desperate. And nevertheless, they might still kill us and carry on ruling us. If they do carry on in the position they're in, we will die. We've got to do something about them. Anyway, so that's the first thing. And specifically, I want to say something else that happened now. The next thing is that a couple of months ago, I met Paul Watson. I met him because of another activist, Pamela Anderson. She's a big, big friend of Paul because she cares about animals. And she used to talk to the fish in the sea as a child. And she's spent her life doing good things. She's brilliant. And she said, you have to meet Paul. And so I did meet Paul. And he came to our fashion show. She arranged that. And the first thing I said to Paul was, Paul, have we still got time? And, you know, are we too late? Is there a chance? Is it all in the pipeline and we're finished? And he said, absolutely, there is a chance to save the world. And his answer was, we have to regenerate the oceans. He then gave me a little booklet. And this booklet is the most wonderful activist's tool. It's so clear and it's specific. And on every page is a subject like overpopulation or whatever. And after it, there's about 8 bullet points per page. Analyze the problem, give the solution, end of the 8 points. It's absolutely brilliant. So looking at the page regarding we must regenerate the oceans, he said, the first thing you have to do is stop countries subsidizing industrial fishing. That's a solution. It's absolutely wonderful because that's what this little pamphlet does. It just goes to the source all the time. It's not messing about with, well, we'll get these statistics together and we'll do this, that and the other. So I want to ask Paul about the regeneration of the oceans and whether if we do... Wait a minute, he did say to me what's already been said before, that the oceans give us 80% of everything we need, oxygen, sequestering waste, sequestering carbon dioxide. And what I want to know is, could we even make the Earth more cool by regenerating the oceans? He said it would not take long at all to get all the fish back. I will. But yeah, okay. Can we do anything about the polls? Can we do anything about, is it in the pipeline, or can we cool the earth by this process? I want to ask you that first, Paul. Yeah, and then I want to ask you something else about it. Yeah.
For millions of years, the biodiversity in our ocean has kept everything running smoothly. And it's only been in the last couple of hundred years that a species that really doesn't belong there has gone in there and has created incredible devastation and totally disrupted that life support system. Some of you may have noticed that we have a life-size blue whale on the banks of the Seine. It's near, close to the Eiffel Tower. And the reason that was put there was as a symbol of what the whales mean to the ocean. And what we're trying to say is that whales actually can save the planet. And how that works is this. 50% of, more than 50% of the oxygen that we breathe comes from phytoplankton, which has already been said. But since 1950, we've had a 40% diminishment in phytoplankton populations. Why is that? Because in the 20th century, we exterminated 90% of the whales. Now, the phytoplankton feeds the zooplankton, which feeds the fish right off the scale. But what feeds the phytoplankton? The whales. And to be blunt, the planet can be saved with whale shit. Every day, one blue whale dumps 3 tons of fecal matter into the ocean, rich in nitrogen, rich in iron, and that is the nutrient base for the phytoplankton. If we want to bring back the phytoplankton, let's bring back the whales. And that's why that's so important. You know, all of those species, prey, predator, working together, have kept everything running as a life support system on spaceship Earth. It's worked perfectly. But we've gone in and decided that everything is really for sale, and we can do whatever we want. And we're literally investing in extinction. For example, the bluefin tuna. There's about a 15-year supply in warehouses in Japan right now, frozen solid, ready to for market. But they keep catching them. If they stop fishing bluefin tuna today, there would be enough to feed the Japanese people for the next 15 years. Why don't they do that? Why don't they allow the fish to regenerate? Because if they do that and the fish populations come up, it lowers the price of the fish that's in the warehouse. Scarcity translates into profit. They want the species diminished. And extinction, if it goes extinction, you've got 15-year supply worth billions in profits. And so while we're seeing this all over the world, in killing elephants, as you kill elephants, the elephant populations are diminished, the price of ivory goes up. So it's an economic system which is destroying this planet.
Is it too late? Can we still turn it around?
Well, if we can force the governments to actually uphold their own laws and regulations, because we have all the rules, regulations, treaties to protect the Earth. We have a lack of economic and political motivation on the part of those governments to do anything about it. For instance, this last December, we went after 6 pirate poaching vessels, toothfish poaching vessels in the Southern Ocean. Everybody's knows they're there, has known they're there. They've been on the Interpol purple list for many years, but nobody did anything about it. So we went down there to do something about it. And we were immediately criticized by the various governments. You can't do that. You can't take the law into your own hands. You can't do that. And we said, well, you're not doing it, so we're going to do it. So 8 days after leaving Australia, we found the Thunder. The first thing it did was drop its nets and run. So we sent a ship in pursuit for 110 days, the longest maritime pursuit in history. And our other vessel, the Sam Simon, pulled in that 72 kilometers worth of net, 70 tons of net altogether, brought it on board. We chased the Thunder off the coast of San Tome. They couldn't go anywhere. They couldn't hide anywhere. So the captain sunk his own ship in order to destroy the evidence. Our crew went on board, got the evidence before it went down, and then turned them over to the authorities in San Tome. And we were able to shut down the other ones as a result. 2 in Cape Verde that we found there, another one in Malaysia, and 2 in Thailand. And the result of that is to show that non-government organizations have the power to make a difference. They can do something.
But you also provoked a collaboration. It was initiated by you. At the end of the day, you worked together with law enforcement. You worked together with governments, with Navy, and all these
kind of brought together an alliance, or at least a network of, yeah. of different partners, which broke the whole ring down, right?
Yeah, so Interpol then cooperated with us, and so you read the Interpol report, they say how successful it was. They sort of keep our name out of it. But I actually like to say that Sea Shepherd, we're the ladies of the night of the conservation movement. People agree with us, but they don't want to be seen with us in the daytime. because we're too controversial on that. But you have to be controversial. You have to take action. You have to stand up and say, look, you know, you can't continue to do this. Right now, the Japanese whaling fleet is heading down to the Southern Ocean in defiance of the International Court of Justice that said that what they're doing is illegal, in defiance of the International Whaling Commission, in contempt of the Australian court. If this was Uruguay or Nigeria, they would be stopped. But because it's Japan, they're not being stopped. So we have to go after them. Our vessel left yesterday to do just that. And over the last 10 years, we've cut their quotas from anywhere from 30 down to 30% to 10%. And as a result, we're called pirates and eco-terrorists. I keep telling people I'm not an eco-terrorist. I've never worked for Monsanto. And so therefore, you know, I'm just a... But when they began to call us pirates, I decided, okay, well, we'll be pirates. You want us to be pirates? We'll be pirates. Because you know what? Pirates got things done back in the day.
Well, I have to actually answer the question about will it cool things
down? Yeah. And well, Vivian's question was, will it cool things down? Well, here's the problem, is that the phytoplankton, which feeds the zooplankton, causes a diminishment in zooplankton, added to the fact that we're actually removing millions of tons of zooplankton to feed domestic animals, turning it into fish meal. When you lower the zooplankton populations, you remove those animals which actually sequester carbon dioxide. And therefore, you cut down on that sequestering. So we need to do is regenerate life in the oceans. And it doesn't take that long. A 40, 50-year moratorium will do it. And if you can do that, you jumpstart that life support system again, and you get everything working in order. And that will restore the system in the ocean. And I think it will address all of those problems, acidification, and also, I don't know if we can stop the cooling completely, but it will certainly push it in the right direction.
And one it will question. Reduce the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, yes. which is heating the Earth anyway. I think that's very important.
It'll do that, but you know, carbon dioxide is the least of our problems, because carbon dioxide will trigger the release of methane. Methane in the ocean, methane in the permafrost, and when that happens, then we've got a problem. So we need to solve this problem before, and it's already started, so we need to stop this, you know, because otherwise we're looking at becoming Venus.
One question, Vivian.
No, I've got to just finish the point I started to make. Sorry, it's really important because it involves everybody here and it's something you can do. And I started off saying about how every activist is doing something specific. And when I started, I won't take a second, I concentrated on the rainforest because I thought that's so important. We have to do something about that. Leave that to one side. We're doing something. The Queen's even helping us with it. But then, really, probably a more important thing that I realised when I met Paul is to regenerate the oceans, to save the oceans. And so if the source of that problem, the first really big problem, the main problem, is industrial fishing, then what I'm saying is, as activists, we have to join together and constantly say, this is such a super amazing thing we could do that would be efficient and it would kickstart, like you said, it would really be such a major, major thing to do, that this is what everybody in this room has to do. We have to just lobby or talk to people, constantly talk about we have to reduce, we have to stop the subsidy to industrial fishing. It's as simple as that. I think with that, we might even save the planet. And you've got to come on demonstrations to show the government that there's a big opposition. It's your duty, and that's what you have to do. That's enough for the moment.
And we need...
What else? What else can you do? Especially, what else can the creative community do? What else can designers do? You are a designer. end of the day. What can you do with your profession to
I can,
fight?
But I've got to ask Paul another question, sorry. Which is,
sorry, I mean,
I've got to, because it's more important than what I do about designing. Buy less, choose well, make it last. That's my main thing. But I think it would really make sense if Paul would tell us one bit more about how we stop subsidising industrial fishing. I think it's very interesting for everybody to know how things work. And so what I want to ask Paul is a question I asked him earlier, which is, what happens to those ships if they're taken out, if they can't now make a profit because they don't have the subsidy? What happens to the people who own those ships, and what happens to the ships? I think it's all part of knowing this, then it makes us know we can do this thing.
Well, we can find other uses for the ships, including the fact that we actually use those ships, and we're building a navy for the whales and the other creatures of the sea. We have 9 ships right now, and most of them are former fishing boats. So that's one of the things that we can do with them. But really what I think that we need to address is the fact that the strength of an ecosystem is in diversity. Therefore, the strength of any movement is in diversity. Diversity of ideas, imagination, and creativity. So everybody's skills, everybody's abilities, working together actually make a movement. And that's the second law of ecology, is interdependence, the interdependence of all of those ideas and imaginations. So I think that really is the key to success, is really getting everybody from different backgrounds, different skills, working together to address the problem.
Which pretty much answered my question, the artist warrior, the role of the creative community in this. And I'm very thankful. And we can continue later to talk, but we went over time already.
No, but I just got to say what he told me, which is that if you take away the subsidy, the ship it is worth ever so many millions of pounds, but it only lasts for about 12 years and then it's finished anyway. So all that profit that they make is really due to the subsidy, and they spent all these millions, all subsidised, to make a profit. And I think that we can understand that they won't mind getting rid of their ships
because the world knows subsidies are the problem.
And the subsidies are your money. It's tax dollars.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. That's the message.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I'm going to introduce a film, and then afterwards, Sylvia Earle. Hi, can you hear me? I'm going to introduce a film by Sylvia Earle. She is an incredible woman. I'm so proud to have her here tonight on the stage. Cyrill and her are going to have a conversation after we show this short film. But just to introduce her, for those of you who don't know who Sylvia Earle is, she's been a National Geographic Explorer in residence since 1998. She's the first female chief scientist of the US National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. It's a mouthful, but it's a huge, huge fucking achievement. And she was named Time Magazine. In Time Magazine, she was named as its first hero for the planet in 1998. So we're gonna show the film, and then we're gonna hear a few words from her before we go into before we break for dinner.
The most ambitious project yet in ocean research has just started here in the sheltered bay of a beautiful West Indian island. Called Tektite 2, it's the underwater base for a research project being run by a group of American universities with United States government backing.
When I was at Harvard in 1969, I saw a notice on the bulletin board. How would you like, as a scientist, to spend 2 weeks living underwater? Down in the Virgin Islands. That was the pitch. I had already been diving a lot, more than 1,000 hours, and published a number of things. And it didn't occur to me that women need not apply. And Jim Miller, the head of the program, who had to finally make the call, said, well, half the fish are female, half the dolphins, half the whales. I guess we can put up with a few women.
Now, a team of divers will attempt to live for 2 weeks as quiet residents on the seafloor. Ironically, these aquanauts are not men with extraordinary physical endurance and stamina, but five young and attractive women, the world's first real-life mermaids. Their leader is a renowned scientist, Dr. Sylvia Earle, a marine botanist and an experienced diver. And so they settle down with all the comforts of home, TV, refrigerators, and wall-to-wall carpeting.
You're warm and dry while you're inside, but you slip through a hole in the floor, and you're in the water. And we could be in the water 10, 12 hours a day. I felt like a kid in a candy store, except that everything was living. You're outside with the creatures, and you just get to know them as individuals. You actually see this group of five angelfish that are always there first thing in the morning. And they have different attitudes, different personalities. That's, I think, what has given me a different perspective than most probably have. Not just about the ocean, but about the creatures who live there. I went into the Tektite project as an ivory tower scientist, not really in the public eye, but Tektite changed everything. I had to get out of my shell. We had a parade down the streets of Chicago. Mayor Daley gave us the keys to the city.
On to tell the truth, pick out the real Sylvia Earle.
Sylvia Earle is number two.
American woman, stay away from me. American woman, listen what I say.
Sylvia Earle was a pioneer, invading the flannel shirt, bearded oceanographer image.
There was a real sense that women simply couldn't do this. Well, they couldn't pick up the tanks. You can't pick up that equipment. Here, let me help you with your gear, little lady.
She really broke through the barriers. And for that, every woman scientist, for example, should be very grateful.
Wow, wow. Sylvia Earle, she smashed gender stereotypes in the 70s, and she continues to smash perceptions today as an incredible leader in marine biology and conservation. So I'd like to invite her to the stage. It's a real privilege to have her here. Please give her a round of applause, Sylvia Earle.
Thank you.
Sylvia, hi. I'm happy.
I'm happy to be here at Parley with you.
With you and...
And you.
So, a lot happened in the last 50 years. You started to discover as one of the first human walking around on a seabed, being down there, being fancy, being a pop star.
Not really. And, maybe if the fish think that. But.
And what changed from when you first went down there till now? What happened in that 50 years?
Well, I actually first took the plunge in the 1950s. And getting to dive, if you haven't done it, put it on your bucket list and make it happen. My mother waited until she was 81. And she said, if you are 81, don't wait any longer. And, you know, give yourself a gift, a face mask, fins. Well, that is a good start. And as we heard earlier, if you're up for it, you know, just hold your breath and take the plunge. But as a scientist, although that free diving is so liberating, the joy of just being weightless in the ocean. But I want to spend time and really get to know who lives there and to sit and watch, and it's hard to do when you're just holding your breath. Living underwater, I've done it now on 10 occasions. Last, most recently was 2012 in Key Largo. I spent a week underwater there with 5 colleagues, not counting the fish, able to go out day and night and get acquainted with creatures who live their lives out there in the ocean. They're dependent on the ocean, but then so are we, I now have discovered. I've had a chance over thousands of hours of exploring the ocean using more than 30 different kinds of submarines, building submarines, trying to get people to drive them to see below where divers can go, below where even whales can hold their breath. The average depth of the ocean is 2.5 miles. The maximum is 7 miles. It's a living minestrone out there. As Paul pointed out, it's not just the big things, it's the little guys that shape the world. Well, there's so much we did not know in the 1950s. We've learned more about the ocean and why it matters to everyone, everywhere, since then than during all preceding human history. We did not know about the mountain chains. The tallest mountains, if you count the one in Hawaii, from the base up to the top, is way higher than Mount Everest. The base, of course, is underwater. The top sticks out. But it's not the only big mountain. Whole mountain ranges, valleys, just this incredible diversity of life. We've just begun to explore the ocean. We're at the edge of the greatest era of exploration on this planet ever. Only about 5% has been seen, let alone explored, below where divers can conveniently go, below 100 meters or so.
It sounds like outer space.
It is, and it's dark and it's cold, mostly cold, but filled with life, and a lot of them with little lights. But at the same time that we have learned more about the ocean, we've lost more. And I think that's the question
you were asking. That's the second question, exactly. Yeah. It's like beauty on one side, discovery, exploration.
But joy.
What did you see? What do you witness? What is the state of the oceans out there right now?
About half the coral reefs are either gone or are in a state of sharp decline. About half of the forests on the land and the mangroves that border land and sea, seagrass meadows, kelp forests, and as Paul pointed out, the plankton, the forests of the sea, the little guys. Some are so small and so eluded our ability to find them that they, one kind called Prochlorococcus, get that, Prochlorococcus, if you like to breathe. If you don't like to breathe, forget it. But Prochlorococcus generates about 20% of the oxygen in the atmosphere all by itself. 20%, every one in every 5 breaths you take from this one kind of blue-green microbe that is so tiny, which is why we don't appreciate it, so small that we didn't know of its existence until 1986. So it doesn't, anyway, there's so much that we have yet to learn. But one thing we did discover, maybe the most important thing we discovered in the latter part of the 20th century, as we learned so much about the ocean, is that it is vulnerable to what we're putting in, vulnerable to what we're taking out, vulnerable to our ignorance. And so we see the trends. Here's where whales were at the beginning of the 20th century, and we are so good at killing, so good at marketing the animals, the wildlife from the sea. Here's where they were, and by the middle of the 20th century, they were really in peril. I mean, they still are, but some recovery has been possible since most nations, Japan, Iceland, Norway, not among them, have stopped killing the whales for the most part, at least deliberately. We kill them in other ways, with plastics, with
pollution. Down to the plankton that actually eat plastic.
Absolutely, and poisoning the ocean with, and taking their food. When we kill krill, we're killing whales. So that wonderful krill oil you see that you think might be good for you, well, think again. It's not good for the ocean, so it can't be good for you either.
How can we stop the killing?
Knowing, you know, if everybody had even a glimpse of what scientists have come to understand in the last few decades, that we have lost so much, I can't imagine that they would be idle, that they would not do everything they could to turn things around. Stop eating ocean wildlife. Stop the killing. Really initiate this new wave of caring.
But fish is so healthy.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think, you know, go back 10,000 years, we had, you know, our lifestyle was mainly by hunting and gathering. We still ate a lot of plants. Plants have always been the basis of the human diet, with, you know, supplemented a little bit by the animals that we eat. But it's gotten way out of control, especially with 7 billion people to feed and clothe and have a place to live and all of that. And we just can't feed that many people or even a fraction of that number with wildlife, whether it's from the land or from the ocean. So,
what can we do to make everybody know? I mean, that's a trick question because we know what we're going to do.
Yeah.
But what will we do to let everybody know?
We parley. We do what we're doing right here. We're sharing the view and hoping that you will share it too. That knowing is the key. Once you know, there's a chance you might care. And never before have we been blessed with more knowledge than, I mean, more than... You know, kids today are the beneficiaries, and we kids, all of us too, are the beneficiaries of all preceding discoveries. We're armed with insight that we could not have half a century ago. We did not know. We thought the world, and certainly thought the ocean, was too big to fail, that we could always breathe the air. There would always be fish in the sea. And even if we did kill all the fish, so what? So what? Well, now we can see the connections with the whales, with the nutrients in the ocean that feed the phytoplankton, that generates the oxygen, that captures the carbon. Here we are in Paris with climate talks going on. And the ocean is not even on the balance sheet. Well, maybe it will be by the time the talks are over because of the noise some are making about, well, where is the ocean? The ocean drives climate, drives weather, generates oxygen, captures carbon, drives the water cycle. Everything anchors back to the existence of that ocean. So, you know, we're talking about food and everybody's hungry. So
we're going to have a vegan meal actually tonight.
I like it.
We convinced, I mean, actually we didn't really convince. We spoke to our partners here, Les Bains, and we have this policy at Parley. We always have vegan food. And they jumped in and they said, you know what? We got this amazing, Philippe, this amazing 2 Michelin star chef. And he's a French chef. But he took the challenge. And tonight we're going to eat vegan food.
Yeah. All right.
So, and it would
like
be great. And enjoy.
That alone does is a big step toward reducing your carbon footprint. Mm. And we all kind of can take charge and do that. One thing, just one thing. The idea that by protecting the ocean, we can, as Paul pointed out, if you stop the killing and start the caring, designate areas in the ocean like parks on the land, hope spots, places that if we really embrace them and protect them as if our lives depend on them, there's a great chance that in the next 50 years, we'll have a planet that's working better than the one that we've got right now. We can still breathe, but going forward, you can't count on it. When you look at what we're doing to the oxygen generators, the carbon capturers, the way we're driving the temperature of the planet up, acidifying the ocean, all these woes, but there are solutions.
And one of the solutions is actually something we decided lately to do together. We want to talk quickly about the World Ocean Tour, about
hotspots. Yes, go, please. Okay.
So we're going to build submarines. You're going to build submarines. Liz will build submarines.
We're going to invite everybody here to fly in submarines.
It will be a submarine on one side, or two actually, that will explore hope spots, will explore special areas. And they're going to go in there like camera vessels. They're going to have everything what you need to shoot 360-degree 3D, VR, whatever. Mm-hmm. And we connect that with a world tour of a big dome that is an exhibition and that is a cinema that pretty much connects Sylvia's adventures with us people living in the, not in the oceans actually, we're living in the cities. It connects the oceans with the cities, and that's what we're gonna do, and that's what we're kicking off right now. It's an early stage, we can't really share so many details, but we invite you to talk to us. And
is there anybody here who'd like to dive in a submarine? A clear sphere to go down 1,000 meters and see the little luminous creatures? I think, Paul, you'll go, won't you? Anybody else up for this? Who's in?
All right, we sold it.
You can
somebody
take, you
just
can,
collect the credit cards and we can build these things.
No, you can take your kids. Mm. You can take your favorite politician. And if he doesn't behave, you can leave him there.
What does change when you're down there? What will change when we are successful with this? What will change when people are diving, when people are exploring with you, with us, the deep sea? Can that save the oceans?
You know, for one thing, we'll go around and pick up the trash that's at the bottom of the ocean. It's not all on the beach. There's a lot of it there. It's not all in the stomachs of birds and whales and things and turtles. There's a lot of it that's still hanging out down there on the bottom of the ocean. And one of the things that would be great to do is put these little submersibles in the service of cleaning up our junk and letting the world know that when you throw something in the ocean, it does not go away. And that when you look at the surface of the ocean, you're not really seeing the ocean, you're just seeing the top of it. And when you send cameras down to the bottom of the ocean, you're not really seeing the ocean. The ocean is this part. It's the juicy bit. It's the salt water filled with life from the surface to the greatest depths. And little kids flying up in the sky 7 miles, and you know, mountain climbers go to the tops of mountains, but our access to the sea is just beginning in a way that can be accessible to everyone. And we need that because we need to know what's going on. Right now, it's hidden from our view, so it's easy not to care. But we're going to change that.
We're going to start a waste management company in a way. So solutions, that's pretty much the introduction to the second part after you had your amazing food. We're going to speak more about solutions, and here's one, and
okay.
We're going to make it happen.
All right.
Thank you for your time, Sylvia.